What if we measure a cubit? If we measure a cubit, we might measure it in the standard basis. Intuitively, what this means is that we're going to look whether the state is 0 or 1. It turns out that if the cubit is somewhere in the middle, in a superposition between 0 and 1, then we will generate answers with some probability. The probability of these measurement outcomes, for instance, for outcome 0, can be computed by looking at how much 0 is actually in our qubit vector. So we'll compute this by considering the inner product between psi and 0. If we compute the inner product in our example, we have alpha 0 plus beta 1 . So let me write this out. Remember that this is the bra, so this is the conjugate transpose. This is the zero vector. So what we'll get is alpha squared. We can also compute the probability of obtaining the output 1. And again, this is just given by how much of 1 is in this vector. So we'll compute the inner product between psi and 1. And we can easily do this as before. And we will find that it is given by beta squared. So evidently, if we ask, is it 0 or 1, then these probabilities should add up to 1. So the sum of the probabilities of seeing a 0 plus the probability of seeing a 1 is given by alpha squared plus beta squared. And remember that because our qubit was normalized, this was precisely 1. We now see that there was also a very good reason why we had taken qubits to be normalized vectors of length 1. Because this precisely means that if we measure it, here in the standard basis, the sum of probability adds up to 1, as it should. What happens to our qubit after we measure it? Let's say that this is our qubit. And let's say that we have measured it and we found the measurement outcome to be 0. This only occurs with some probability, but let's say that we end up there. If we obtained outcome 0, the qubit will now be in the state 0. So the state has collapsed to 0. Similarly, if we saw the outcome 1, then the final state would be 1. So we've collapsed to superposition and we have lost the information about alpha and beta. We are just in one of the two classical basis states. It turns out that we can already find a cool application of what we've just learned. we can see that we can generate genuine randomness from a deterministic process. In a classical world, like a classical computer or classical machine, it is not possible to produce two random numbers using a purely deterministic process. If there's no randomness to begin with, there's no randomness at the end. In the quantum world, however, we can produce random numbers from a deterministic process. Imagine that we build a machine, and if we push the button, the machine will prepare this state. Let's remember what this is. It is an equal superposition between 0 and 1. Let's imagine now that we take this qubit and we measure it in the standard basis. If we measure in the standard basis, we can get two outcomes, namely either 0 or 1. So let's compute the probability of getting outcome 0. We'll apply our rule, namely we're going to compute just how much 0 is contained in the state. So what's this? Let me write this out, and I will use now the bra and cat notation to write this as bra of 0 and bra of 1 with the 0. So what's this give us? We have 1 over square root 2 times 0 with a 0 plus 1 with 0. But remember that the elements of the standard basis are orthogonal. So this here is 0, and because all vectors have length 1, this here is just 1. So putting this together, we get that the probability of obtaining 0 is a half. We can, of course, also compute the probability that the outcome is 1, which is the inner product between psi and 1. I'm not going to do this computation, but you should check that this is also half, as we would expect, because the probabilities should add up to 1. Here we've seen that we've built a deterministic machine, a deterministic process that prepares a qubit in an equal superposition between 0 and 1. And if we subsequently measure it in the standard basis, we produce random numbers 0 and 1 with equal probabilities. Quantum random number generators that perform a very similar operation actually already exist and are commercially available.